is Launa Lane, and I am a member of the Board of the Trustees of this congregation. Welcome to you all. The Unitarian Universalist Fellowship of Elkhart is a welcoming community encouraging religious freedom, nurturing individual, spiritual, and ethical growth, celebrating diversity, and promoting a just and sustainable world. And for those of you that may not know, this is our mission statement. If you would like to learn more about this fellowship, please look at our website at uufe.org and join us after the service for our coffee hour. For the listening enjoyment of all, we ask at this time that you please turn off or turn your cell phones to vibrate. Also, if you need hearing support, please ask for the help at the sound desk in the back of the room. Thank you. Fellowship Life. August 19th at 10 a.m., we will be honoring the life of Charlie Bussard. Please join and celebrate his life with us as you are able. And it is the first Sunday of the month, so after service, if you are able, please help move the chairs to either side so that way our cleaning crew can sweep and clean. Thank you.
We ring the gong three times. Once for those who came before us and made a place for us. Once for those who are here now. And once for those who will come after us and build on the dream. And this is by Erica Hewitt. To encourage means to hearten, to impart strength and confidence. This is our work as a religious community, to encourage one another, to be bold in engaging the world around us, as well as what scares us internally. To give one another the confidence and heart to live as fully as possible. We as a congregation with full hearts, we affirm our relationships with one another. We recognize our agency and our connective power, and we accept our responsibility to be bold and courageous. We light this chalice, symbol of all that we are, all that we have done together, and all that we will be as we share, as our shared ministry encourages those within and beyond our walls. Good morning, I'm Susie Holzshuh, and I'm new at the Boys and Girls Club, and when I was encouraged by Laura to do the open employment enrollment there, I showed up in jeans and a t-shirt and flip-flops because I was just being curious. And I was able to get a job there, which I'm so thankful and grateful for, because when I went online to look at their mission statement to see what was what. This is what it says: to enable all young people, especially those who need us most, to reach their full potential as productive, caring, responsible citizens. I've been saying that for years. I spent many years in residential juvenile treatment facilities working with kids, and that was my whole focus, was working with kids so that they could, I could plant seeds so that they could become responsible, productive citizens in the world. And I'm like, well, I'm obviously supposed to work there. So what we're here today is to really meld the mission of this congregation and this UUFE congregation and the Boys and Girls Club, because my understanding is that we're really great at volunteering individually, but it would be fabulous if we could show up as a community. And so we have three possibilities for that. Mentoring, which is one-on-one, and we have a wonderful program that's part of the education program. You meet once a week, working with a small group of kids weekly, building relationships, and providing an amazing, important service, which is stability and continuity and commitment so that those kids really can experience that. Then we have tutoring, which is directly related to, you know, one-on-one helping kids who need help the most in being able to further their education in learning skills and critical thinking skills. And then the volunteering as a group. I mean, I understand that they have people that come in and wash windows, play games, which would be fabulous, because that allows us, the staff, to be able to provide the safety and structure and the movement within the organization, where you get to like hone in on a small group of kids and, you know, really give them the time, the quality time that they need. And that's really basically all I really have to say, because I'm new, I'm learning my job, and I would love to see our congregation there as a group, because looking at everybody here and those that are not here, we have hundreds of years of experience and knowledge and heart wisdom and mental wisdom. So come on, guys, let's do it. Thank you.
Oh, right. I know how to do that too.
Thank you. Because I did my musing before the coveted. I was so excited. All right, so, which I really love, and that's one of the reasons why I joined this, is because of this. Okay, so let's do the unison covenant. And you know I cry because my heart's open. So, it's just part of who I am. All right. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. This is our covenant. Okay.
And now we'll do the offertory. This week's will go to our UUFE Sustainability Fund.
Thank you. If you're willing and able, would you please stand and rise and sing 128? Thank you.
Morning.
Good morning.
Well, as many of you know, I work at the Boys and Girls Club. I'm going on my 12th year there with the after-school program. And when I first started, staff actually did mentor a lot of the kids. And because I also work at Northridge, I see some of those kids at school. And then I go to the club and I see them again. They can't get rid of me. But when I started, I was working in Goshen. And I was working with first and second graders. So it was a big difference between the teenagers of the high school and the first and second grade energy. And I had a little mentee, cute little kid. He's not so little anymore because he moved into a different district and started going to Middlebury schools. And I now see him in high school. He's the only student I allow to call by my first name. And so he greets me every morning. And he's now in 10th grade, I think. And he remembered me when he first saw me at school. And so we chat every once in a while. But he remembers the time we spent when he was in first and second grade, talking about Legos, talking about video games, talking about videos, Pokemon, that kind of thing. This summer, going into my 12th year, I brought some of the activities that I've been doing with kids. At Goshen, I taught the kids Star Wars dice. If any of you have ever played Farkle, it's like a very simplified version, but just with Star Wars characters on the dice. Kids loved it. It was it's a, since they're scorekeeping, I would make the kids add up their scores. They got really good at it. Corkle is another one. That became the hit of the summer. This is my travel set, and I think at one time I had six kids playing Corkle with me this summer. And again, it's scorekeeping, so simple math. But the way the game works, you're pairing colors with shapes, and there's different patterns you create with that to get points. So it's working the left brain and the right brain. Corkle is actually gotten awards as an educational game, and the kids love it. Simple card deck, playing cards. I did teach the kids how to play zombie dice. They thought that was fun too. And then this summer, knitting. I would have some downtime, and the room I was supervising did not always have a lot of kids in it. So I would bring my knitting and I would knit. And then pretty soon a kid would come up, "What you doing?" "I'm knitting. Can you teach me?" "Absolutely." So I brought in some scrap yarn I had, some extra needles, and I taught two little girls how to knit. One made a coaster already for her mom. And it got so popular with kids coming up, "What you doing? Can you teach me?" that this fall I am creating a knitting program, the Middlebury Club, for beginning knitters. So that's the kind of impact I've had. Just, I've been fortunate to get paid to do this. But even if I wasn't paid, I would be volunteering, because that's how important it is to the kids in this community to have stable adults come in. And the conversations we've had over knitting has been amazing. The other, just this past week, found another fun activity that I didn't think kids would enjoy so much, and that is unraveling a rat's nest of yarn. It required patience, lots of determination, sometimes cooperation, two people working to unravel a particular color from this ginormous rat's nest of tangled yarn. And it also taught coping skills for when the frustration hit, being able to just set it down and calmly walk away. So these are life skills that a giant tangle of yarn has helped teach some kids this summer. And these are the kinds of activities anybody can bring to the Boys and Girls Club. I mentioned that I started working almost 12 years ago in Goshen. I worked about 8 years in Goshen, and then I've moved to Middlebury during the pandemic. And while I was there, that's where I met Launa Leftwich, who were the area director at first. And Launa has since risen in the club's administration to where she now does outreach for partnerships and stuff. And you have your degree in clinical psychology. So we're fortunate to have Launa working at the club and doing this kind of work. It's incredibly important. And as Susie mentioned, volunteering, mentoring, tutoring for homework help, these are all things that these kids need. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Launa Leftwich.
Thank you, Susie. Thank you, Laura. I feel like we're done, and we all should just go home, because you had heard wonderful representation already, starting with a good call to action, right, out of the gate. I wanted to, if we could start the PowerPoint on slide 3, we could advance to the, yeah, so there's our mission statement, and then I saw her cowering in a doorway adjacent to the gym. Hiding, maybe? She was waiting there, and I asked her, "Can I help you?" She said, "I can't go in there. Cannot go in there." I said, "To the gym?" We talked a little bit more, and she shared with me that she was nervous about playing basketball. "I don't even know the rules." She didn't want to go in. So if we talked a little bit further, and I said, "Why don't we give it a try? Because the other girls don't know the rules either." "They don't?" She was surprised. So we made a plan, and she decided to give it a try, and we would follow up a little bit later. So Christina and I talked later. She said, "I said, how did it go?" "I love basketball." She was so surprised. I asked her to remember this time, to say, the next time you have an opportunity to think about trying something new, think about basketball, because this was a time that you tried it and it worked out great. She said she would. But isn't that kind of our life lesson, that we are patient enough with ourselves to be able to try something new and give ourselves space to be able to learn? But I also had a little reflection of my own. What is our responsibility to a little Christina cowering in the doorway? Whose job is it? Should she figure that out herself? Is that her school's responsibility? Is that her parents' job? Is that my job to help her? So as we think about that, I wondered, what does Scripture tell us about this a little bit? In Isaiah 58, the people are giving their ritual sacrifices. They are fasting with regularity. And yet, Isaiah says to the people, is this not the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the straps of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and to bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them, and to not hide yourself from your own kin? Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator will go before you, and the glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. You shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." Across the country, go to the next one. Across the country and in our community, many people are confronted with mental health challenges, and young people are no exception. The pandemic exacerbated a decade-long rise in youth mental health concerns. According to a survey of youth right now, it's about 1,000 youth reported that 70% of kids rate their ability to cope with challenges as medium to very low. For many young people, the pandemic restrictions, including school closings, social isolation, and missed milestones, could have lasting impact on their developmental progress and, in turn, their long-term readiness for the workforce. And you guessed it, this It's our biggest challenge and our biggest competition, right? We know there are human behaviors that one cannot learn from a screen. How does a preschooler learn to share? How does an elementary child learn to make eye contact? How does a middle schooler know and learn give and take or coming back from a loss in checkers? How does a little girl learn how to try and risk for basketball? These are lifelong transferable skills that impact not only youth, but our community as well. Friends, there are plenty of youth development organizations involved in this work, and I'm here today to talk about Boys and Girls Clubs of Elkhart County. But there's enough work for all of us, and no one organization can do it alone. In Elkhart County, we have 4-H, United Village, Big Brothers, Big Sisters, Lifeline, Tolson Center here in South Central Elkhart. All of these are a blessing to our community. However, each one of these is only as good as the number of adults in the room. So, as we think about this, I wonder if you wouldn't be interested in knowing a little bit about how Elkhart got started, Elkhart Boys and Girls Club got started, and it started with a need and an access issue. Next slide. If any of you are familiar with Goshen, the north side of Goshen has been a little bit underrepresented and has had some access issues. In the 1950s, this house was our first Boys and Girls Club. But in the 1950s, if you were living on the north side of Goshen and your house caught fire, but there happened to be a train, you had to wait for the train to be done before the fire trucks could come to your house. They've since remedied that with an overpass, but when this was the Boys and Girls Club, that was the situation. This is the Theda Clark house, and the then leaders of the city said, we've got to do something about this problem we have with boys on the north side of Goshen. They're running around after school. So they purchased this mansion for $1 from the owners who were done with the home at that time, and they contracted with the then Boys Clubs of America and chartered their own boys club in Goshen. And so they would set out cookies here on the steps in this photo to invite children to come to the house after school, and they were as they were walking by from Chamberlain and other schools there in the neighborhood. So that started in 1956. We started our first Boys Club of Elkhart County. And then in 1982, you can hit it again, there we go. The construction, after this Theda Clark home was raised, we built a new building on that same site there in North Goshen. In 1982, the construction began on the new Goshen Club. And then the next slide, in 1986, we offered a membership to girls. So that was a novel thing. We changed that to Boys and Girls Clubs in 1990. We changed our name. And then this is Napanee. In 1998, we opened a club in Napanee. And then after that, in 2002, we opened our club in Middlebury. And then in 2010, Elkhart, we started a club at one of the elementary schools and then a teen center in Bristol. More recently then, in 2017, we have the current club in Elkhart, adjoining Beardsley Elementary, and we have a great relationship with Elkhart Community Schools, so those kids can walk right from the elementary right into the club. And then in 2017, we also renovated the Goshen Club and expanded that as well. Then in 2019, Napanee moved from a shared space to its own freestanding clubhouse there in Napanee. And then lastly, in 2020, this is Laura's workplace, the expanded Middlebury Club opened its doors. So that's kind of a quick summary of the facility expansion that we've had most recently. And we know that it is an investment that these spaces provide for our after school opportunities. And we will, these are measurable results that especially are meaningful to our working families so that they can work full time in our communities. Boys and Girls Club do drive these measurable results for our youth, because we also know that for every youth that is in after school time, there's three waiting to get in. Parent satisfaction is at an all-time high of 94%, and 95% of club teens, 9th through 12th grade, say they feel like they have what the skills needed to be successful on a job. 57% of those club kids have also had some work experience. For every dollar invested in Boys and Girls Clubs, it gives a return of $9.60 in current and future earnings, as well as cost savings for our community. So our focus for the future happens today, as Boys and Girls Clubs offer a fun, safe place where kids can go after school to grow beyond the classroom. Laura gave a good example of seeing that happen during the day and then in after school time. Club programs from education, the arts, sports and leadership, and service help young people be prepared for college or career after high school. In fact, we know career exploration starts as early as age 6. And, you know, when kids want to help around the house or to try some kind of creative neighborhood enterprise, through life and workforce readiness programming at Boys and Girls Clubs, clubs encourage kids to identify roles that interest them and to learn to initiate a project and see it through. These, and incorporating these opportunities to build financial literacy. We encourage budgeting and saving and thinking about how money comes in and money goes out. One of our popular programs is joining forces with Junior Achievement and participating in Lemonade Day. The kids get together, they create their own product with a local business, and then they sell that and they realize the returns on that. Sometimes their products are very creative, lemonade and blueberries and fizzy. I mean, they do have very creative ideas, Oreos, all those fun things, but they are being able to try and to risk. We also know that when they see adults that look like them in a variety of roles, kids are able to dream big about what they might do and visualize those possibilities for their own lives and careers. It's important for youth to have opportunities for essential technical and academic skill development. Each of these photos was from our summer programs and different opportunities that our kids had this summer. I think it's also important that you know that we cultivate a spirit of service with our kids. It starts very early as kids help each other. We have youth ambassadors, so the first day that someone arrives to club, an older child will show them around and show them where to go to enjoy different parts of the clubhouse on their first day of school. Middle school, we have Torch Club that practices service, And then Keystone is our high school service club. We teach them that through service, we have something to contribute, and we belong to something bigger than ourselves. The Keystone Club, they select their own officers, and they're required to plan those service hours both inside and outside the clubhouse. They raise money to travel to a national Keystone Conference that gathers all of these Keystone Clubs from around the country, and they celebrate service and their personal brand, what they stand for as teens. If you remember this slide, this is of our Goshen Clubhouse in 1956. And a couple years ago, I was privileged to give a tour to two club alumni. One was in his 70s and one was in his 80s. And they were able to see the amazing space we have today. They were blown away about the opportunities that we give our kids. And as we shared some of these photos, we reflected on those steps. They remember going up those steps in this very clubhouse. They remembered playing ping pong. And as we reminisced a bit, one of them said to the other one, "You know that Jerry kid? I think he's cheated that one time. Do you remember that?" I'm still not over that part, you know. So we laughed a lot about some of those shared experiences that they had. And friends, I got I got chills thinking about how important that was for those two men. Here are two people that had full lives. They had full careers, families. They had it. They had arrived. And yet they still were able to understand and reflect on those experiences when they were teens. And I thought, how cool is this? This is amazing that we get this opportunity to invest in people. Who knows where they might go? So these steps here that you see, I told you that this building was raised and we built a new building on top of that same site. Well, we retained these steps. You can still go to Goshen and see the steps from this original site. And we keep those to teach our kids, to say, do you see these steps? These symbolize the generosity of people who have gone before, who have invested in us and who have given this amazing space to us. And we also keep this to say, not only does it symbolize the gratitude that we have, but it also is for them to teach their friends, for them to know generosity and to demonstrate that to the people who come behind them. Right? This is what it's about, is passing it on, paying it forward, however we want to share that. But these steps represent gratitude and generosity for us in Elkhart County. Next slide. This practice of gratitude is just part of the soft skills that we give to our kids, along with communication, teamwork, and emotion management. The club is an environment that supports holistic and experiential learning of technical and academic skills, along with essential soft skills necessary to navigate relationships at school, at home, and at work. Youth development professionals like Susie and Laura know that at club, they recognize the impact they can have on club kids' emotional well-being. From communicating how they're feeling to building coping skills that support resilience. And on the next slide, you'll see our newest staff member. This is Albert. He is our therapy dog. And as we have adopted a trauma-informed practice for mental health programming, we've joined with Albert. He is going to be visiting all of our kids at the clubs. And we know that that helps them learn empathy. Sometimes kids will read to a dog differently than they will to a human. I still laugh because he looks like he's smiling in that photo. I'm not sure how he got to do that. But as a result, we see the resilience in participating youth and enthusiasm for connecting with peers and club staff. In fact, today's youth have strong social emotional awareness. Those club kids that participate regularly, say 90% of them say they are able to recognize their own feelings and emotions and understand how their feelings impact their actions. Next slide. Those clubs have stepped in also to provide tutoring. Susie talked about this, academic support in ways that are fun and engaging to ensure that young people stay connected and continue to set high goals for schooling and eventually their career development. So you've heard the call to action. We cannot do it alone. So we do invite you to be involved at whatever way that you feel you can. But it's providing that access, that support, and that justice for everyone. There's not a category of youth or of people that deserve something different than another. So I invite you to consider volunteering, becoming a reading buddy, homework tutor, or a coach. Come once a month to play games with our kids. Share a passion or hobby that you have with kids. We had a guy who came to create a harmonica club, and the kids loved it. We didn't know that from a survey. It was the person who was sharing from his heart that they engaged with him. They love time with adults, and they need us. Also, if you feel like maybe time or volunteering isn't your thing, we do accept resources to support innovative programming. There are lots of ways to contribute at all dollar amounts, and you're invited to create some awesome experiences through monetary gifts to create these life-changing impact for our club members. And you remember Christina, the little girl that was afraid to play basketball? Well, she is now a lead distance runner in track at her high school. And although her mother immigrated from Romania, Christina excels in writing English essays. She loves it. She has developed leadership skills, competing and becoming Youth of the Year for her Boys and Girls Club. She is one of hundreds of stories that demonstrate the way our light changes the outcomes for others. When it is dark, just a little bit of light has an impact. But friends, let us not be content with just a little bit of light. Let our light break forth like the dawn. And as Amanda Gorman says, for there is always a light, if only we are brave enough to see it. If only we are brave enough to be it. Amen.
Hope we can ask you questions after the service. Okay, good. Well, we've been encouraged to let our light shine, so let's sing about it. Number 118, stand and sing if you're able, and we'll sing 118. Thank you.
Christina was in my room at Goshen when she was in first and second grade. It's like, I remember, yeah. Our benediction today is by Tom Shade. A Power at Work in the Universe is the title. My friends, there is a power at work in the universe. It works through human hands, but it was not made by human hands. It is a creative, sustaining, and transforming power, and we can trust that power with our lives and with our ministries. It will sustain us whenever we take a stand on the side of love, whenever we take a stand for peace and justice, whenever we take a risk. Trust in that power. We are together held by that power. Blessed be. And if you will stay seated for the postlude.